Desmond Tutu. I think we have a really good set of questions we're going to ask him. I think we're going to learn a lot.
I think we've made an enormous amount of progress in the past couple of days. I think we've really done a lot of work, and I think it's paid off. We have a good arc, a lot of questions, and a lot of interesting things to ask him, and I'm really excited about what we're going to hear.
I'm really excited to go interview Desmond Tutu, as we've talked about him a lot in class, and we've done a lot of interviews and read his book.
Yeah.
So I'm excited to meet him in person.
How about if we started with a prayer? Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of thy faithful people and kindle in them the fire of thy love. Send forth thy Spirit, and they shall be made, and thou shalt renew the face of the earth. Amen.
Amen.
I want to welcome you. I know, I mean, you're going to do the honors, but let me just right at the start, give you a very, very warm welcome, despite our weather. As you know, it's our winter.
It really is a joy to see you again, and I thank you for all the things I know you need to be doing to take time with this group. It's such a privilege. Talia, do you want to introduce the group and get things moving?
Hi, I'm Talia. Thank you so much for seeing us today. It's a pleasure and an honor to be here. As you know, we are students from the Mount Madonna School Values and World Thought Program. And we've prepared a few questions for you today, but we'd also like to give you some time if you have any opening thoughts you'd like to share with us.
Yes. Let me not take too much time, because I'm sure you are more interested in your in being able to give your own questions. But I think it would be important to say that God has a lot of time for young people. And when we look at the biblical record and subsequent human history, it's quite amazing how frequently God has used young people to accomplish God's purposes. But it's just to say that most young people are fantastic in being so idealistic. You are, as it were, just at the beginning part of this adventure that is life. You have, and I hope you continue to have these high ideals, the dreams that you have of the world. It isn't a world as God would want it to be, obviously. You look at our own country, we have done wonderfully well in throwing off the shackles of political oppression. And yes, we have done some things well as a free nation, but very much less well in a number of areas. Our world is not as God would want it to be. Your country spends billions on arms when a very, very small fraction of that would ensure that no child anywhere in the world would die because they didn't have clean water, they didn't have enough food. And you know, we were helped a great deal in our struggle against apartheid by people like you, students at colleges and universities who were part of the anti-apartheid movement. There's still a lot of ugliness in God's world. I can bet my bottom dollar, as they say, that almost all of you believe that you can want to make a difference. And all I would want to say is, for goodness sake, keep on dreaming. Don't allow us oldies to infect you with our cynicism. Dream. Dream, and you will find actually that you are dreaming God's dream. What God really wants our world really to be. Who wants to ask the first question? Yes.
Hi, my name is Daniel, and we have noticed that across the world, people are worrying and praying for Nelson Mandela, and it seems you have shared so much with him in the anti-apartheid movement, and both politically, spiritually, and as a friend. Could you talk about what he has meant to you personally over the years?
Yes. People are actually very surprised to discover that when he was released in 1990 and came to spend that first night with us at Bishop's Court, that was only the second time I had met him. Because, well, the first time was I was still a student at college. And we had a debating contest with a school of social work, and Madiba, bless you, and Madiba was the adjudicator. And when I was Archbishop here, and he was on Robben Island, I asked for permission to go and visit them. Predictably, I was refused the permission. So our only communication was by letter. He's been an enormous influence on many of us. Our country, most people, sane people, we're expecting that we were going to have the mother and father of a bloodbath, racial bloodbath, there was just no way in which you could have a peaceful transition from injustice to freedom. And I think that many of us were beginning to think that that was inevitable. And then it turned out that somebody upstairs was betting for us. And we were given this extraordinary person. You know, people often say, 27 years, what a waste. And they are quite shocked when I say, the 27 years, those years were absolutely crucial years. They were necessary. Because he went into prison an angry young man. And his experiences in prison, as you well know, suffering can make a person either bitter or it can make someone to be magnanimous, to be... We were fortunate that his suffering had this very salutary outcome. In the 27 years, he learned to be understanding of the other's point of view. He could put himself in the shoes of his Afrikaner jailers and understand their anxieties. They had been told that the anti-apartheid movement was really communist, it was atheistic and so forth. And you could understand why they were scared. And so from being angry, he began to be sedate and magnanimous. And we were very fortunate that he was then to take charge of the ship in that transition. We ought not to undervalue the role of Mr. de Klerk. I mean, had he been an intransigent person, it would have been much more difficult to have had this. But that was a major influence on me, that he could come out preaching forgiveness and reconciliation at a time when his own movement, most in his own movement, young people, were wanting to fight to the bitter end. And the last thing they would have imagined was talking about forgiveness and not retribution. Yeah. That's, I hope it covers some other questions, because I've gone on to a little too long. Yes.
Hi, my name is Ruby, and I am curious to know what you felt at the moment when you took Mandela's hand and stepped out onto the balcony to introduce him as the next president of South Africa.
Oh. I mean, there are things that are indescribable. Can you describe your first kiss? No. No, but I think actually, that there are things, there are experiences. When you become a father for the first time, you really are at a loss for words to describe how you feel when you hold that little life in your hands, and I'm the father, of this bundle of life. I'll tell you actually what I said quietly to God. I said to God, after I introduced Madiba to the crowds in South Africa and in the world, I said, God, if I die now, I really don't mind. I won't mind. It was just an incredible moment, almost really indescribable. you know, because it was dreamlike, you know. Here we are standing in line to go and vote in South Africa. You keep pinching yourself. No, man, it can't be real. And it was. So, yeah. I said to God, I can't think of anything more incredibly wonderful than to have been given this honor. And basically I was saying to God, I know you can't top this. And then God said, okay, try me. And there David has got the picture. Thank you, David. Yes. But God in fact had still something. I mean, to be asked to chair the Truth and Reconciliation Commission was just fantastic. Yes, I'm going to try and make out that I'm quite modest, you know, and I won't.
Hi, my name is Olorin. I was wondering how difficult it was to convince people to agree with the establishment of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission after the end of apartheid.
Yes. I think almost everywhere victims are incredibly magnanimous. You know, the people who get clobbered and you think are going to be just eager for retribution and revenge. It's quite, I mean, it is amazing just how frequently people are willing to forgive. In our culture, there is something called Ubuntu. Have you have come across that?
Yes.
Yes. All right. Which inclines people towards being forgiving, accepting that you are keen to restore fellowship, relationship. So your jurisprudence is sort of restorative rather than retributive. But when you get to think that, oh, it's a peculiarity of Africans, one of the most wonderful things that happened here is, have you heard of Amy Beale? You would have what? You'll go and maybe visit her foundation here. Amy Beale was a Fulbright scholar and was working at the University of the Western Cape. She was a white American from California. One day, a friend of hers, a black friend, said, she decided to give her a lift home. And obviously, I mean, there was a segregation. And the lift home was to a black township, Kukuletu. And yes, they drive to Kukuletu, and as it happens, there's a large crowd of black kids who, there was the slogan of one of the parties, white settler, one bullet, one settler. And they were shouting this slogan when they saw her, and they chased her. She, I don't know why, but she got out of the car and tried to run. They overtook her and they killed her quite gruesomely. Two of that crowd were sentenced to very long terms in prison. They came to the Truth and Reconciliation Commission to apply for amnesty. And Amy Beale's parents came all the way from California to here. They could have opposed the granting of amnesty, which would, an opposition which would have been taken very seriously by the panel. But do you know, Amy Beale's father, he has since died, stood up they were sitting and said, we support the granting of amnesty to these young people. And when they were asked why, he said, they know that this is what Amy is expecting us to do. Now that's a fantastic act in itself. Amazing. But that's not where it ended. Because they then founded the Amy Beale Foundation, which is working especially from Kukuletu, trying to rescue young blacks from going astray. And I think at least one of the two guys was employed by the Amy Beale Foundation. And you may still be working there, I don't know. So I was just trying to say, don't think, I mean, that it is a tray of black people. I mean, one of the first of the people who came before the commission to tell their story was a white woman who had seen a lot of her friends killed at a Christmas party by one of the groups here, and she was quite disabled, and it's almost like you think, no, I am making up these. This is such a lovely story. It's made up, but she. She was sitting there, maimed, still with some bullets in her body, and she said she'd like to meet the person. I think they threw hand grenades. I'd like to meet the person who threw this hand grenade that. Injured me so badly. I want to give him what for. And she said, I'd like to ask him to forgive me. I mean, did we hear it right? Yes, and I hope, I mean, that, yeah, I would forgive him. I mean, he would fantastic. I mean, people are quite incredible, really. It's been a fantastic experience. Sitting there and I mean, that we would expect that people would be consumed by anger and bitterness, but most of our experience, 2-3 years of the commission, were anything but. I mean, they were really very. I said on one occasion, we ought to take off our shoes because this is holy ground. When people who by rights should have been consumed by bitterness and anger, it was quite extraordinary. One of the shames, the great shames of our country is that some of the people who needed it most, a lot of the white people, I mean, were very, very dismissive of the commission and didn't take the advantage. And so they are suffering still from the trauma of having part of a system that did what it did to fellow human beings. Okay, don't you think I've sung for my supper?
My name is Jenny. And it seems to me that Jesus is a historical figure, was a revolutionary force. What do you think the life and teachings of Jesus would say about what is needed right now to conserve the intention and essence of South Africa's anti-apartheid movement?
Yes. You're a wonderful professor. Yes. We have not yet grasped just how revolutionary our faith teachings are, you know. Because far too frequently, I mean, we are speaking often in situations which are relatively okay, relatively okay. But I don't know how you would understand in a situation where you are treated like rubbish, where you can have, as they had in this country, notices that said natives ourselves, natives and dogs not allowed. Now, you don't have to be too subtle to know that they are saying natives, us, and dogs are on the same level. And well, actually, they treated their dogs much better than they treated us. And then you introduce to those people an incredible teaching, you know, one that says, do you know what? You're created in the image of God. You, and you, and you. Now, what does that mean? We actually don't quite grasp the full significance of this, which is that you are a God carrier. You know, you're a God carrier. When I meet you, I shouldn't just shake your hand as we do, but we ought to be doing what Buddhists and Hindus, people especially in the East, do, which is really bowing very profoundly. The God in me greets the God in you. That to wrong One such is not just a wrong, which it would be. Do you know what? If we took our theology seriously, it is to say it is blasphemous. You are treating that other person as you are doing, really spitting in the face of God. We don't take it seriously. You know, as you can see from how we still treat one another, that, I mean, I said, if you saw me in the red light district of one of your towns, would you have said, no, we are sure he's there to carry out evangelical work? Nobody would. Very few, let us say, very few would imagine that I was there for anything but XXXX, yes. But I don't know, maybe we've quarantined and cleansed the Gospels quite a bit, because some of our Lord's closest friends were prostitutes, you know. And one of them, who is one of, I have three patron saints. I needed three to keep me out of mischief. One of them is Mary Magdalene. Now, it's not quite clear whether she was, but I myself believe that she was. It's the Mary Magdalene who was a prostitute, who became the queen of penitence, and who was the apostle to the apostles. That's the first person our Lord met, Mary Magdalene, a woman, a former prostitute, and in a society that was so against women, he sends her to the men apostles. She's the very first person to have spoken to our Lord after his resurrection, a woman. Now, that was quite a deliberate act. In a sexist setup, and to say to her, go and tell, it's a fantastic thing to go and tell my brothers. Now, my brothers are the guys, one of whom betrayed him, another denied him three times, and all of them abandoned him, except for the women. And maybe one other man disciple. Now you have to tell me, what was I answering? What was I answering? You have to discover, I mean.
What do you think the life and teachings of Jesus would say about what is needed right now to conserve the intention and essence of South Africa's anti-apartheid?
It's really just to say, these are human beings created in the image of God, and you should leave it at that. That ought to be enough to shake up anybody. that, hey, do you know what? You are doing this not to, it's actually God that you are spitting at. None of us, very, very few of us actually work on that basis. God wears an incredible disguise. But if we were for real, this world would be what God wants. You know, that lovely image, God wanted us to be able to live as if in a garden. You know, where there was no bloodshed. You remember, everyone in the garden was a vegetarian. They didn't kill to eat. Now we can justify, maybe we can. But basically, it was that God wanted us to know that we depended on one another. That is why God could say about Adam before Eve that it's not good for this guy to be alone. Maybe Christianity is too radical for us, for our comfort.
Hi, my name is Preeti. In a recent interview, Alan Bostic asked, how is it possible that we, as a society, talk with such convictions about the right to own instruments of murder and death, and not have the same enthusiasm for the right of people to have shelter, or the right of the vulnerable to be taken care of? He went on to say, we have the freedom to redefine power as a force based on servanthood and not just domination. Ordinary people, churches too, have a role to force politicians to respond. What do you think is the role of the church in helping to redefine how we as a society use power?
He's very smart. He is. He was the most eloquent of us. I mean, he could mesmerize a crowd, and in minutes they would be eating out of his hand. He's an incredible orator, isn't he, David? There's no one, really no one. I tried not to be jealous, you know. But yes, I mean, the form of the question already contains its answer. You know, because he's saying, what's happened to our standards? I mean, why are you able to allow, what is it, NP something, the national something something that is so passionate about owning guns, NRA,
National NRA. Rifle Association.
I mean, can you believe it? After what's happened at that school, what's happened in Colorado. I mean, what right is absolute? Maybe, yes, the right to life. But even that, what you do when a pregnant mother knows that if she carries the baby to term, she's as sure as anything going to die. I'm just saying, you, we have not always been true to the principles, the founding principles of our faith. I mean, Jesus tried in so many ways. When he healed on the Sabbath, and they castigated him for doing so, trying to say, hey, these laws are made to be life enhancing. They are made for the sake of human beings. They are not made to be glorified and held up there, as it were, on their own, so that they are a kind of idol. And Alan has a very, very sharp intellect, and as I've just said, I mean, he's able to go to the heart of the matter in next to no time. Yes, if we in the church were able to have shown that we are life affirming, that for us the most important thing is a human person, and that anything that it's a fantastic question to ask. Yeah, I mean, how do we become servant leaders? And in many ways, I mean, the new Pope Francis showed when he used public transport in Argentina and lived not in the palace. And now here, I mean, in Rome, he is causing some consternation because again there he goes to eat with as do everybody, Yes. We would turn the world upside down. But we then, I think, show that we value the things that should be valued. That we would say, what does this do to people? What consequence does this have on children having more access to good education, to good health? Does it? If it not, then it is something that we must throw overboard. But we don't always do that. It can be tough. Because when we are human beings, like things that show I am me, you know, and we find it very difficult to live into the image of the boss going down on his knees to wash feet. How will you know that I'm the chief here if I don't come in a shiny automobile and with a huge retinue? Yes, well, so over to you. Will you be able, or will you try, let us see, will you try to make this world just a little bit more like what God would want you to be. Aha! God bless you.
And his laugh is so contagious, and it's really awesome to see how much he can impact you just by looking at you and saying something incredibly simple can mean so much, and I know I'll definitely remember it for a very long time.
I want to hear in about 5 years' time that you really changed the world, okay?
Okay.
Yeah. God bless.